In this video, we will take a look at group theory, which is a cornerstone in building fundamental theories in physics. This might be a concept you are unfamiliar with, but the essence is not very complicated. It is based on symmetries. As it turns out, symmetry is very important in particle physics. These symmetries form symmetry groups, and actually the structure of a standard model comes from a certain collection of symmetry groups. In this video, we will take a look at these symmetry groups and discuss what a group is. To do this, we will first discuss some simple groups before considering the slightly more complicated groups of the standard model. But before we start talking about groups, we should first take a look at what symmetries are. The first step for us would be to recall what symmetries are. To do this, let us consider an equilateral triangle. This is a triangle where all the sides are equally long, and likewise this means each corner has the same angle. This triangle has three symmetry lines. These lines run from each corner to the opposite midpoint. Thus, if you put a mirror along these symmetry lines, the mirror image will complete the triangle correctly. Similarly, if you rotated the triangle 120 degrees, you'd end up with this same looking triangle. This is only possible when the object has symmetry. Thus, if you took this triangle and rotated it 120 degrees, nothing would change. Only if you labeled the corners would you realize that something changed. This is what group theory is about. And this equilateral triangle is described by a group called the D3 group. A group is formed by two main things. Firstly, the different ways we can configure our object. Thus, in the case of the triangle, it would mean all the ways we could mirror and rotate the triangle to obtain a similarly looking triangle. Secondly, we need an operation to get from one configuration to another, and in the case of this triangle, it could be rotations or mirroring. There are also some more details to what a group is. To discuss more details about what is required to form a group, we will discuss another very simple group. This group is the set2 group, or the cyclic group. We can represent this group in several ways, but let us consider the following representation. This group has two elements, which is the different configurations we can have in this group. Thus, this group is even simpler than the D3 group. The elements of this group is 1 and minus 1. The operation of this group is multiplication. Thus, we can multiply 1 times 1, that is just 1, or 1 times minus 1, which is minus 1, or minus 1 times minus 1, which is just 1. So no matter what we do, we stay within the elements of the group, and this is a requirement of the group. Just like with a triangle, no matter what we do, we stay within the elements of the group. Formally, there are three actions for a group. The first is called associativity. In relation to the set2 group, this means that if you want to multiply three numbers, like 1 times 1 times minus 1, then if you multiply first 1 times 1, which is 1, and then you multiply 1 with minus 1 to get minus 1. This result should be the same if you multiply the two last numbers first, thus 1 times minus 1, which is minus 1, and then multiply the first number with the result of the two latter, thus 1 times minus 1, which is minus 1. Thus we see that we get the same result no matter where we start multiplying the numbers together. And that is the first requirement. The second requirement is that there must be an identity element, which means there must be an element that does absolutely nothing. In the case of our example, it would be to multiply with 1. If you multiply a number with 1, nothing happens. Finally, there must be an inverse element for every number, such that you get to the identity element. Thus, if you have minus 1, then multiplying with minus 1 gives you 1, which is the identity. Thus, all three axioms are upheld in the set2 group. I hope you have a rough idea of what a group is by now. So let us move on to a more complicated group called the U1 group. This group is in one way very different, because this group is infinite. This group has an infinite amount of elements and it belongs to a special class of groups called Lie groups. And this group is very important in physics. This group can be described by the complex unit circle. The elements of the group is all the points of the circle where the absolute value of the complex number is equal to 1. Because the group is just like a circle, one can move between the different numbers by considering some angle theta. We call this the generator of the U1 group. And this generator allows us to reach any point on the circle by moving by some value of theta. This group is very important in physics, as it turns out that this group forms the structure of electromagnetism. When we look at the transformations of the electromagnetic field, we use the generator of the U1 group. What is very interesting here is that the generators of groups turn into particles, which are the force carriers. Thus, the one generator of the U1 group, which forms the electromagnetic force, this one generator becomes the photon, which is the electromagnetic force carrier. The U1 group is rather simple and not too difficult to imagine visually. Things become a bit more complicated if we ask ourselves if we can generalize the U1 group. This idea leads us to the group SU2. This is the group of not complex numbers, but complex 2x2 matrices. Because we are now considering matrices, then instead of demanding the absolute value of complex numbers being 1, the condition is that the determinant of the matrices in the SU2 group must be 1. In the case of this group, one can use the three Pauli matrices to describe this group, and using these matrices we can reach any element in the group, similar to how one can reach any point in the U1 group using some angle theta. But note that this means there are three generators of the SU2 group. We can then consider the even more complicated group named the SU3 group, which just like the SU2 group is composed of matrices, but now it is 3 times 3 complex matrices. Just like before, the condition is that the determinant is 1. This group is represented by the 8 Gell-Mann matrices, thus we have 8 generators for the SU3 group. Now, why have I discussed these groups? Because these groups form the structure of the standard model. The standard model gauge group is written in terms of these three complex groups we just discussed, and we can write the standard model as SU3 cross SU2 cross U1. Remember what I told you about generators and their relation to particles. If you look at the standard model, we see there's one photon representing the electromagnetic force, and this photon comes from the U1 generator. Likewise, the SU2 group has three generators, which turn out to be the bosons of the weak force. Formally, these generators are broken by the Higgs mechanism, and thus the weak force bosons are massive. Finally, we have the SU3 group, which, as you might have guessed, represent the strong force. And since there are 8 generators, we likewise have 8 gluons as the force carriers of the strong force. Thus, from this underlying group theory, we get the underlying structure of the forces behind the standard model. Furthermore, these symmetry groups also give us the constraints to how the standard model as a whole is composed. And in this way, the standard model is a beautiful example of symmetry at the foundation of physics. In this video, we have discussed symmetries and how they are mathematically used to form groups. And these groups have certain properties. As it turns out, some of these infinite groups turn out to be very essential for physics, and in this video we have looked at the beautiful example of the standard model. As we have seen, the standard model is based on group theory, and from the group theory we obtain our bosons that are responsible for the forces. Thus, forces are directly linked to the group theory, and the rules of the forces come from the group theory. Since all this group theory is about symmetries, we realize how important symmetries are for the fundamental description of the world. As always, I hope you learned something new, and if you have any questions, put them in the comment section. If you like the content and would like to support the channel, check out the link in the description. If you like the video, please like, subscribe, and share it with your friends, and stay tuned for the next video.